landlocked salmon, lake trout, rainbows. These and other species of game fish provide excellent fishing in New Hampshire's many large, deep, clear lakes. These big fish require tremendous amounts of forage fish for food. In New Hampshire, salmon and lake trout depend on smelt as their principal food item. Each spring, during the period of ice out in the lakes, tremendous numbers of adult smelt leave the lake and descend streams in which to spawn. If no streams are present, spawning will take place along the shorelines, with practically any type of bottom being utilized for spawning areas. In Winnisquam Lake, one of the inlets most heavily used by smelt for spawning activities is Black Brook, Sanbrinton, New Hampshire. Let us follow the smelt as they come in from the lake and start up Black Brook to spawn. After passing through the sluggish area where the river enters the lake, the smelt swim upstream until they reach swift water flowing over sandy or gravel bottom areas. It is here that most of the natural spawning will take place. In the inlets to most lakes, the spawning runs occur from just after dusk until the early hours of the morning. But at Black Brook, the smelt are not disturbed, and many remain in the spawning area throughout the entire day. The males, or jacks as they are called, generally precede the females by about a week to 10 days, usually dropping back into the lake proper during the daylight hours. In Lake Winnisquam, the spawning run starts about the first week of April, but females do not begin to appear until about the second week, and the actual spawning starts somewhere around the 20th of the month. The spawning activity will reach its peak about the first week of May and is generally over by the 15th of the month. During the spring, hundreds of people eagerly seek these small silvery fish with long-handled dip nets. But because of the importance of our smelt egg program for providing sources of food for salmon and lake trout throughout the state, this particular brook is closed to smelt dipping. Here at Black Brook, an artificial spawning site, 80 feet long by 20 feet wide, has been constructed by the New Hampshire Fish and Game Department. This area with a concrete bottom has been divided into five raceways. From the time the females start depositing their eggs until the end of the spawning activity, one or more section will remain open so the smelt can enter. Since it is natural for a smelt to swim upstream, they will fill the raceway from the head all the way down to the lower end. Wooden frames covered with burlap make an efficient, low-cost tray on which to collect the eggs. The trays are anchored to the bottom and held fast by large rocks. The rocks also act as barriers, forming eddies and pools behind them, which provide resting places for the smelt after their tiresome journey upstream to the spawning sites. The flow of water through each raceway is regulated by flashboards in the dam at the head of the raceway. After a set of burlap trays has been placed in a raceway and made ready for the collection of smelt eggs, the flow of water through the raceway is increased, urged on by the extra flow. Tremendous numbers of smelt will ascend and completely fill the raceway, resulting in maximum numbers of eggs deposited and collected each night. Here we can see the smelt over the trays, facing upstream, ready to spawn. Since this brook fluctuates greatly during the spring, it is necessary to control the amount of water rushing through the artificial spawning area. This is possible through the use of flashboards in the dam situated at the lower end of a bypass, especially constructed for this purpose. During heavy rainfalls, when the brook tends to flood over, boards are removed so that the excess water will rush down through the bypass. If the brook becomes low, the spillways are closed, backing up the brook so that the water must then pass over the dam at the head of the collecting area, thus guaranteeing that fresh amounts of water will constantly be flowing over the trays of smelt eggs. Since the spawning season for suckers is approximately the same as that of the smelt, it became apparent that unless a method was devised to prevent suckers from spawning on the trays, fertilized sucker eggs would be transplanted along with the smelt eggs. Wooden framed wire screens keep suckers from entering the raceways. These screens must be kept clean of leaves and other debris to prevent the water from building up behind them and eventually spilling over the top. If this happens, then suckers are able to leap this waterfall and pass into the smelt egg collecting area. To prevent this from happening, the screens must constantly be turned and cleaned. It is also necessary to keep these screens clean in order that the smelt can pass through them. The smelt can quickly and easily pass through these coarse screens and into the spawning area. Here they will deposit millions of eggs on the trays each night. Both male and female smelt appear alike in regard to size, color, and external appearance. However, the males are covered with breeding tubercles during the spawning season and feel gritty, whereas the female smelt lack these tubercles and feel very smooth when picked out of the water. Preliminary work has indicated that many smelt in Winnisquam Lake spawn when they are 1 year old and average about 4.5 inches in length. A few large females, 8 to 10 inches, spawn in Black Brook each year. These fish have been found to be 3 years old. Taking scales from these smelt and recording their length and sex on the scale envelopes is done in the field laboratory at Black Brook. Later, the scales will be read to learn the ages of the spawning smelt. Before the concrete spawning area was constructed, the egg trays were just placed on the brook bottom and anchored with large rocks on each corner. Unfortunately, after the trays were left to collect eggs for 2 or 3 nights, tremendous amounts of sand and gravel accumulated on the trays along with the eggs. Very often, many or all of the trays collected only a few eggs. In many cases, many of the eggs collected were lost due to suffocation because of sand and gravel which completely buried them. By comparison, the trays in the collecting area are not subject to this condition of heavy silting, which would result in egg suffocation. Both trays were set at the same time. The tray set on the brook bottom is practically covered with sand and gravel, whereas the tray taken from the raceway has about a 1/4 inch layer of smelt eggs and is free of all other matter. Notice the even distribution of the smelt eggs on the tray taken from the collecting area in contrast to the tray set on the brook bottom. As the smelt proceed up into the collecting area, the entire raceway becomes so crowded that it is sometimes almost impossible to see the bottom. From these vast numbers of smelt that come up and spawn, a few will die. Some become crushed against the rocks or manage to wiggle under a tray or rock, which might kill them. These dead fish may then become infected with a fungus parasite, which, if left untreated, could spread over and completely infect and kill an entire raceway of eggs in 2 or 3 days. To prevent this, each raceway of eggs is given a daily treatment of malachite green. The crystals are measured by weighing and are then dissolved into a gallon of water. This standard solution is poured into a drip pail at the head of the raceway, where it slowly pours from the pail into the water flowing over the egg trays. The solution flows over and completely covers each tray of eggs. All raceways are given a 1-hour treatment each day. This treatment has resulted in the complete elimination of egg losses from the fungus parasite. As the season progresses, the waters recede, and any eggs in the brook which become exposed to air and sunlight dry out, die, and turn white. Fortunately, this condition can be prevented by controlling the water flow over the eggs in the collecting area. Each tray will contain up to 500,000 live, fertile smelt eggs. In managing lakes for this important forage fish, it is important that we know how many eggs are stocked in each lake each year. To obtain this information, lead plates covered with burlap 4 inches square or 16 square inches in area are set at random on the trays along the entire length of the raceway. After the eggs have collected on the trays for a few nights, these plates are picked up. Since only a very few smelt eggs will stick to the wooden frames, a person is able, by stepping only on the wooden portion of the trays, to walk along the raceways without destroying many smelt eggs. Smelt eggs are very sticky when deposited and adhere to the burlap covering on the plates, just as they do on the burlap smelt trays. White thumbtacks are stuck into the lead plates, so they will be easy to find after the trays and plates have been covered with smelt eggs. The eggs are then removed from the plates into a pan of water. These eggs have already become water hardened, and it is now a very simple matter to roll the eggs off the plate by hand. After being measured, these eggs are placed in the brook below the collecting area, where they will later hatch. After all the eggs are removed from the plates, they are poured into a glass graduate, which is measured in cubic centimeters. Samples taken resulted in an average egg count of 835 eggs per cubic centimeter. By measuring the number of cubic centimeters of eggs collected on the plates, it is possible to determine the number of eggs collected per square inch on each tray. The number of eggs collected per tray is carefully recorded, making it possible to know how many eggs are stocked in each lake. The biologist performs numerous investigations and devises methods and techniques designed to improve the quality of the eggs being shipped out. Meanwhile, the smelt continues to battle their way up and into the raceways and spawn. Nature's driving forces will make them fight with their lives to pass all obstacles until they reach a suitable area to spawn. As soon as an adequate number of eggs have been deposited on the trays, about 500,000 eggs per tray, the coarse screen at the lower end of the raceway is removed, the smelt are driven out, and a fine meshed 1/4-inch wire screen is put in its place. This screen will prevent the smelt from re-entering the raceways and depositing more eggs on the trays. The trays of eggs in this raceway will be held at Black Brook until the eggs are eyed. This will take approximately 12 to 15 days. Samples of eggs that are being held are picked up each day with a syringe. The eggs are then transferred into labeled bottles so that eggs from each lot of trays can be identified. The eggs are then put into glass dishes and checked through a microscope. Hundreds of eggs can be checked in a very few minutes. By checking different lots of eggs, we are able to determine in how many days they will hatch. Thus, we can plan on stocking the trays 1 or 2 days prior to the eggs hatching. This will result in maximum hatching success in each lake that is stocked. Valuable data obtained with the help of the microscope is recorded on the smelt egg charts. Records of each set of trays placed in a raceway are kept. Information obtained includes the degree of embryo development, percentage of fertile eggs, and the general condition of entire lots of eggs. As soon as microscopic investigation reveals that a lot of smelt eggs are about ready to hatch, the trays are given a final treatment of malachite green. Any silt which may have accumulated on the trays is washed off as the trays are removed from the raceway. Every other tray has wooden cleats fastened to the top at the center. When the trays are stocked, they are stacked too high. The cleats keep the trays apart so that clean water can pass between them and prevent destruction by suckers and other predators. The water flowing between the trays will wash the newly hatched smelt fry into the brook and down into the lake. The trays, each containing approximately 500,000 eyed smelt eggs, are then loaded on a pickup truck. After the egg trays are loaded on the truck, the entire lot is covered with wet burlap bags. A few pails of water are poured over them as a final precaution against drying. A tarpaulin is spread over the entire load and tied down. Although most trips average less than 6 hours, some eggs are shipped by truck 8 to 10 hours without any losses. The truck driver checks the load every couple of hours and wets the egg with brook water if necessary. Earlier work involving shipping techniques proved that eggs could be successfully shipped in this manner for periods up to 36 hours if the eggs were kept moistened. Finally loaded, the truck has about 80 to 100 trays, or roughly between 40 and 50 million eyed smelt eggs as it starts its trip to various stocking sites. As the truck leaves, a conservation officer radios the officer who is to receive the eggs that the truck is on its way and tells him where and when to meet it. Meanwhile, the raceway just emptied is swept clean. A new set of trays is put in place. New count plates are randomly spaced and the fine mesh screen is removed from the lower end. This raceway will soon be ready to collect 94 more trays of smelt eggs, numbering approximately 40 million. As soon as the screen is removed and the water flow through the raceway is increased, the smelt will again enter the raceway to continue spawning. Arriving at the lake to be stocked, the fish and game manager meets the conservation officer scheduled to receive the eggs. Now both the manager and conservation officer will carry the egg trays along the brooks as close to the lake as possible. The trays are set in clean running water on a sandy or gravel bottom and are held in place by large rocks. These trays were held at Black Brook for a period of about 15 days. During this period, the embryos have fully developed and are about ready to hatch. Within 2 or 3 days, tremendous numbers of fry will hatch from each egg tray. Practically all the eggs on each tray will have hatched within 5 days from the time the egg trays were transferred from Black Brook to the stocking site in a lake. Finally, the payoff. After weeks of careful planning and scientific management at the smelt egg collection station at Black Brook, here we can plainly see the smelt embryos fully developed and twitching in their eggshells just prior to hatching. Finally, an extra kick and the fry break from their shell case and are able to swim and start life. From each tray, about 500,000 of these tiny transparent smelt fry will hatch and be carried to the lakes. In the lakes, millions of these smelt serve as the most important forage food to produce or grow large game fish such as this. Smelt in New Hampshire's large lakes have proved to be the necessary link in the food chain needed for producing large, fighting, landlocked salmon, such as seen here. Even though millions of smelt will be devoured by game fish each year, many will manage to survive, grow to maturity, and spawn. Each year, about 400 million eggs will be collected, treated, cared for, and transplanted from Black Brook. About 88% of the total egg stock will hatch. This high rate of hatching success has been made possible through research and sound fisheries management practices conducted at the Black Brook Smelt Egg Collection Station.